I don't know about you guys, I don't know what you do for work, but I don't mean to brag, but since moving to Hollywood, I've done a lot of secretarial work. Yeah, any admins in the house? Anybody? No, you work the land. You all, you're forest rangers. We came into town for supplies. And, it's interesting, your show. Normally, we just read by the fire. Or Pa reads from the good book, picking out words he recognizes from the feed store. No, Maria, we don't understand your admin. No, I miss the excitement of secretarial work, you know, because every day I'd wake up, I didn't know if I was going to go in and file something or type something or, like, file something I typed. And I decided that the worse the job is, the more excited the temporary representative seems to be about it.
Hello, Marie. This is Judy from TRC Staffing in Glendale. Good morning. I have an incredible opportunity here for you today. $5 an hour, alphanumerical filing in an industrial warehouse. I thought of you first.
I kept expecting it to get worse.
Hello, Marie. This is Judy. Tijuana, Mexico. Loading fruit trucks. You need to be there in a half hour, corporate dress. Hello, Marie. This is it. I have a feeling.
Temptaperm, Thailand. You are sold into prostitution. But there is free parking.
Sometimes I get kind of a bad attitude about work. You know, I forget why I started temping in the first place, which was to make a difference. And I think it's okay to lie to get out of work as long as you whisper the part that makes it true right after. Yeah, I can't come into work today. I'm really sick of having a job. There's no way I could have gotten that project done. I was super busy surfing the internet for this guy from my kindergarten class who made binoculars out of two toilet paper rolls, and it turns out he's living in Tucson and has two kids, but he's divorced, so it might work out. I gotta leave early on Friday. I got a doctor's appointment with a pitcher of margaritas. And my primary physician, Dr. Feelgood. Whenever you start a new job, they always say it's going to be different, especially with secretarial work. They always say it's going to be different wherever company. They always say,
we do things a little differently around here. It's a little crazy. It's a little nutty. Hang on to your hats. It's going to be a wild ride.
But it never is. It's always the same thing, somebody training you in. Okay, fax machine's a little tricky. Got a dial 9 to get out. A lot of times people try to use the fax machine, they say, it's not working. I say, did you dial 9? Okay, sometimes, you park in the parking structure? Okay, because sometimes we run out of all-day validation stickers, and we're going to have to give you 2 1-hour stickers, but we got an agreement with the parking company that 2 1-hour stickers equals 1 all-day sticker, so it's okay. Okay, sometimes, Maria, sometimes you're going to want to kill yourself, okay? But we only get a half hour for lunch. I can't wait till I go to work one day, and it is really as different as they say it's always gonna be. I come in, they say,
Yeah, it's a little crazy around here. You'll be working for Anne. Anne's the VP. She's kind of a witch. Seriously, she put a Lipton cup of noodle soup in a cauldron, cast a spell over the office supplies. Now the staple removers all have these big googly eyes and will not shut up. Anywho, just ignore Dan. He's always in the employee kitchen nude. Asking everyone using the microwave to do shots of non-dairy creamer off his dingle dangle. He's funny. He has a good sense of humor. Lunch from 12 to 1, but there is a wrinkle in time. So just try to get back any time before the quickening. Here are your flippers, your barbecue tongs. Call me if you have any questions. That's my dream job. So one day I was feeling really down at work, and I was feeling kind of down. I was drinking non-dairy creamer straight from the carton, and that's a bad day. And this girlfriend came up to me, and she said, "Hey, Maria, I've been taking this class. It's really changed my life. Would you like to come to a newcomer's class at 7:30 p.m.? There's no obligation, and it's free." Sure, I'll join your cult. And I went to the cult because they said they had free food, and that's my religion. And they sat me down with the crazy cult lady, and she said,
"Maria, what's something you want to make manifest in your life?"
"I'd like a new car."
"What do you really want?"
"A new car."
"What do you really want?"
"A Toyota 4Runner SR5 Limited, the leather interior that runs on dreams and starlight." She got mad at me because I did not have the cash for the brainwash weekend.
"Maria, let's think of all the ways we can get $495 tonight. Do you have a charge card?"
"Nope."
"Do you have anything you could sell?"
"I bet my soul might be worth something."
"Is there anyone you can borrow it from?"
"Oh, man, if you could spot me."
"Maria, what are you afraid of?"
"Bears."
"What are you afraid of?"
"The North American grizzly."
"What are you afraid of?"
"I am most afraid of being sucked into a crazy, creepy cult." And she told me, and this is something they'll tell you if you try to, if you get into a cult. She told me I was afraid of success, and that's why I didn't want to join the cult. She told me I was afraid of success, which actually may in fact be true, because I have a feeling that fulfilling my potential would really cut into my sitting around time. I got a lot of shit I gotta not get done. I am very busy doing jack. Sir, I'm gonna ask you a question, sir. It's a personal question. Have you ever had sexual harassment at work?
Absolutely.
Yes? No, that's good. No, that's good. He admits it. I think a lot of guys get sexual harassment at work, but they just don't mind it. And so they just kind of let it go. But don't let it go. Next time some lady asks you to move a file cabinet, just file a claim, my brother, because she's watching it. She's watching it. Fight back. I used to have this really creepy boss who'd always come up to me and say stuff like, "I really like it when you wear your hair like that." "Why don't you come in the meeting, take shorthand, cheer up the guys with your pretty face." "Come on, smile for me. You look so much more beautiful when you smile." You know, like, I go in his office, say stuff like,
"Hi, I really love the way your gray, curly neck hair comes up of the edge of your peach, polyweave, sweat-stained sports shirt."
Mm.
Why don't you come in my cubicle and tell me more about my partial dental benefits after 90 days? Come on. Smile for me. The fact that I net $6.49 an hour to provide you with the sexual stimulation you're not man enough to get in your personal life is so much more apparent when you smile.
Sometimes it's worse, though, when you have a lady boss, like especially if she tries to act like she's your friend. Cause you're honey and sweetheart and girlfriend. Hey! I want you to take a break. Take a walk. Get out of this office and get me a latte. And it's 2% milk. You should know that by now. And hey, I'm having a party at my house this weekend. And I really want you to come and you'll meet some really cute, really available men at the door. Park their cars, take their coats, and speak only when spoken to. See us as friends, as equals, even though I earn, what is it, 850% more than you do? And you spend 12 hours a day here stuck in this office while I drive aimlessly around the city looking for caves and tunnels where I can call you with my cell phone. I don't know. My mom asked, or a friend of my mom's asked me, she said, so you're a comedian, so what's plan B? This is plan B. After the whole supermodel astronaut thing didn't pan out, I've been kind of grasping. You know, as I get older, I realize, you know, maybe not all my dreams are going to come true. Like, my mom always wanted me to be Miss America. And there's never been a Miss America whose talent has been stand-up. If I had the correct regional accent, I could still be a contender.
As your Miss America, I would travel all over this great country. From the Chuckle Bucket in Rockford, Illinois, all the way to the Laugh Carafe in Schaumburg, Illinois. I would spread awareness about important causes, like the fact that airline food continues to be of a poorer quality than regular food. Hey, what's up with that? And to all those little girls out there, those future Miss Americas, I give them this advice. And tell them to keep reaching for the stars because those are the only people who can help you. And if someone yells at you to take off your top, just say, hey, jackass, you're confusing a comedy club with the place where your mama works. Thank you!
Thank you. Okay. I was thinking about, like, why I'm still single, and I thought I might blame my dad. And, this is, my dad is a, he's a dark spirit. And, this is my dad's current favorite quote. We're gonna listen to this. This is by former Israeli Prime Minister, Golda Meir. She says, don't be humble. You're not that great. Hey, Dad, I'd have you open for me, but I've already hired an anvil and covered it with a wet blanket. You're bumming me out! I love my dad, and I know he loves me because he calls me every week to tell me that he does. And but it's always with an edge, so I don't know exactly where I stand. Keeps it interesting. Maria, am I bugging you? No, I'm fine. Are you just getting up from a nap or just going down for a nap? Dad, I'm upright and sentient. Oh, I'm sure you're working. Well, I mean, the jokes are coming together and breaking apart and ever evolving dyads, triads, and crawdads. But I have a couple minutes before I have to lay down so they can set. Well, I just want to call you and say how much I love you and I'm proud of you. I want to apologize for all the times I've made fun of you saying, oh, you know, you're just
sitting around bars eating french fries with your friends. Because it looks like you found a way to get paid for it.
Those french fries are not free, Father. Ten percent off. Nachos are always free.
I like being in this comedy club. This is a really nice comedy club, you know. Sometimes you're ever in a comedy club and sometimes you don't know what the show's going to be like, you know, because they're kind of vague in their advertising sometimes. They can be like, we're going to be having some comedy. What kind of comedy? Well, it's going to be comedy, so it's going to be hilarious. Well, it's going to be the kind of comedy I like, which is barrel-chested Polynesian men telling caustic one-liners. Not necessarily. Ladies drink free. And then they had the answering machine. Now, the answering machine here is quite mellow. It's very nice. But sometimes you call a comedy club answering machine. It's like, cock-a-doodle-doo. Thanks for calling the Rooster Cove, home of the 10-cent tequila truck. This week, we hit the hilarious comedy stylings of Maria Bamford. She's a woman of a million voices. She'll have you laughing all the way to 2007. Next week, Pumpkin Stick and his banjo, Steve. Like, you have no idea what's going to happen that week. I wish they'd let the comedians do the answer machine, you know, I'd do it. Be like, hello, you've reached a former nail salon that seats 400. This week, we have my quiet, odd joke stories. I think I only did about four voices, actually. One low, one high, and a couple in between. And I will have you laughing or saying,
well, I thought it was supposed to be Carlos Mencia. Well, it's your bachelorette party. Well, she's already started. You want to...
All the way into the parking lot. Next week, guy who opens each show at the group sing-along about accidental date rape. And then closes with the national anthem. Cock-a-doodle-doo! I've been traveling a little. I've been in Australia. You know what? Our people are not liked worldwide, it turns out. Oh my God. They do not like us in other countries now. Australian people are very, very nice, laid-back people because they're happy. And it's sunny and stuff like that. And they are mad because sometimes our people, are perceived as being irritating and dumb. But we're not. We're loud and charming. I didn't want to come off as like an ugly American, you know, be like, excuse me, top of the morning to your good day or whatever you guys say. Where are your koalas and kangaroos and stuff? How about your Abergigginal people? Is there like a bus to see that or something? No worries. You know what? I am kind of worried. Okay, that's silly. Like, I asked a crowd of people, and I was like, so, has anyone been to the States, whatever? And this lady said, yeah, I hated it. What did you hate about the United States? What did you hate about it? I hated all the food. Like, all the food? What about foods that's the same that's like a hamburger? Like, would you hate that? Yeah. Okay, what if... It was an Australian kind of food, but it was made by an Australian, but you were eating it in the United States. How would you like it then? You hate it then? Yeah. I think a lot of people are lashing out at our food rather than at our government. And I know it's easy to lash out at people about their nationality without knowing them, because that's what America's all about. And, so I can appreciate that. So I don't know. I love my country. Maybe that's because I'm white and rich. But things have been working out for me. Oh, I'm not technically rich, but I do have a lot of shit that I don't need that I refuse to share with others. And that feels pretty solid. All right. Feels good. Like most Americans, I would like to help others while being televised. I like to go to an area of the world where they really need my help. You know, like,
We're here in sub-Saharan Africa because people sometimes have to walk tens of hundreds of miles for food, water, and basic medical care. And that's why we've chosen this village for an extreme makeover! Tell me, Mobutu, how does life feel as a blonde?
Well, my husband didn't even recognize me. And now when I go to the aid truck and fight other women for flour, I feel more confident.
I feel the way about my country a little bit the same way I do about my family. A little bit embarrassed and terrified. But I have marched, I have written letters, and I've sat in nonviolent protest since my mother's policy of telling me messages to give my father messages that are inappropriate, but to no effect on her agenda. Honey, just tell him. No, Mom, I'm not gonna say that to Dad. Just tell him to pick up the Vagisil at the pharmacy. No, Mother. That's wrong. Honey, just say, Mom wants you to pick up the rug cleaner. Jesus Christ. Someone has to stop them. All right. Yeah, I was talking to my mom recently, and she said, Honey, when you don't wear makeup, you look mentally ill. Now, when I go home, I'm certain to wear thick green eyeshadow and a line of lipstick around my lips. Baby, look pretty now, Mommy. I was trying to think of what I would get done if I could get something done, plastic surgery-wise, if I could get something done. I think, I don't know if you could see it, sometimes you could see it. I want to get the part of my brain removed that cares about what other people think. And then have my hands replaced with suction cups. Because it's useful. Does anyone here work in an office environment? Yeah? I used to work in an office, and I've been fired a lot. Has anyone here been fired? Who said they're fired? Where are you fired from? Somebody over here. Where were you fired? Your job. That's general. What job was it? You worked for an eye doctor? What'd you do wrong? Or would they say you did wrong?
You didn't see
an eye. You're a silly goose. That's pretty funny. Eye doctor. I've been fired a lot. I prefer to call it just another stop on my Burning Bridges tour. Then it's more like they paid by the hour for me to rock. And I was working for this giant corporation. Anybody here work for a giant corporation? Anybody here a part of the problem? I used to work for a giant corporation. Let's call it Jubilee Goop. And my supervisor, let's call him Green Bean. I can't say what it is because it was Disney and his name was Chuck and he worked in publicity. But working for Jubilee Goop, and my supervisor Green Bean said there were certain VIPs who you should never put on hold, certain bigwigs who you should never put on hold, and I could never remember who those people were. So I put everyone on hold, and I conferenced them, and I let them sort it out amongst themselves. Green Bean fired me, and he said, "You are never going to work for Jubilee Goop again. You are not Jubilee Goop material." I didn't want to tell him, because he had actually been hired on full-time with benefits, but I had actually been fired from there 14 times before. Dude, I'm a temp. I'll be back. I'll call you next week from accounting. Don't put me on hold, buddy. I don't know. It's always great. Giant corporations, like, they always act like they care. Like Disney, they call you a cast member, you know, like you're in a show or something. But you're in the shitty, boring part of the show that nobody wants to watch.
Unless, of course, you take a 3-hour lunch, then everyone's watching.
Stupid. They did this weird employee recognition event for us after September 11th. It just came off really creepy, you know, because they try to act like, you know, they care, but then it comes off wrong because it's all profit-oriented. Like, they took us out to Palm Springs and said,
"You guys, just amazing job. Great teamwork, everyone did. Round of applause, everyone. You guys did everything to help our customers in the Manhattan area, so thank you so much. And this year, the challenge is, how do we recreate that grief-stricken, terror-driven productivity and channel it into our day-to-day operations? Okay, kidnap a loved one. I like it. Let's spitball.
I love this job. Did you ever like your job, but then feel like, oh, I wonder if we could take it to the next level? You know, like I could be an accountant, but also be a cloud. Every year, rain down upon people. Every year I think of a different job I could do, like this year I was thinking about, I could have been a nurse, you know, like, oh, do you need me to hose that off? I could be a cop, because LA's hiring, right? You know, like down there. Yeah, I could be like, hey, stop it. Like that, I could do that. You know? But I work a lot by myself, and I do really miss camaraderie of working in a place, you know, being with other people, because I'm by myself most of the time, and I miss the, where do I go for lunch? Get like a sandwich or something. Like a salad. Someplace where you get a Diet Coke. Yes, we could, my friend. Yes, we could. I like the drama, you know. Don't touch Donna's labor maker. Okay, don't touch it. Don't. Why? Because she bought it with her own money. Enough said, sister. So I've sharpened my tape dispenser. My nombre. So, I got in trouble sometimes because I get kind of out of control at work. Because other people's food always looks better.
Did someone take my key lime pie your play?
No, it wasn't me. It really wasn't me this time.
Did you eat my Southwestern style lean cuisine?
No.
Did you eat my hat chocolate rabbit? It's just basically half a head with an ear that I've been gnawing on for the past 5 years. It still has a ribbon around it because my mom gave it to me for Easter.
Yes.
Stop it. Stop scrambling things up in your chops.
I like simple foods. I like comedy club food, which is a boon, you know, because I like simple, you know, just, I don't want to hear about the food, you know, and they have fancy restaurants, they say, oh, we're going to terrify the beef, and then we're going to shove it next to some carrots that don't know what's going on, and they're going to try to escape, but they're paddling desperate towards shore, but there's a tsunami of booze juice coming at them. Like, I don't need to know that. Does that shape fit in here? How do we get it in the munching cave? Do you have a dinner blizzard? A blizzard of dinner?
Let's get it in the pipeline. Hey, so yeah, okay, yeah. You know when you're at your public pool and you're just tugboating along on three noodles and a kickboard? Okay. Some kid's like, hey, why are you taking all the noodles? It's not my problem. School gets out at three. I got here at one, buddy. Self-employed. You may have one noodle. So, did anyone here just move to Los Angeles?
Yeah.
Yeah? Do you have a job yet?
Yeah.
Yeah, what's your job?
I work at
Trader Joe's. Okay, that's a good job, right? Because they got bennies, right?
Yeah.
Benefits, and then do you get like the old piñas, pineapples, you know, like the cookies that have been crushed, They're no good. Sorry?
Cookies you get.
That's real nice. It's good to have a job. I don't always move out there. They're like,
you've got to have a job when you come to LA. And that's the only way you can go to LA is have a job.
So I got a job during, I don't know who said that, but somebody in my head said that to me. Clearly.
And they were enunciating when they said it.
I moved out to LA and I started doing Star Trek characters in a touring show. And the tour went to mall openings and Jack in the Box promotions all over Victoria, Texas. And it's a bit of a longer piece, so settle in.
Greetings, I'm Major Lelanka of the planet Bajor. I can see the makeup on your face. Oh, you mean my genetic makeup? Yes, I am molecularly different from you, as I am an alien and you are a human. Greeting. Get the fuck away from me! Get the fuck away from me! Ah, excellent. Good way, hello. I shall try it on the Klingon when he is back from his smoke break. Ah, yes.
Why do you have stains all over your uniform?
Because the Starship Enterprise is not reimbursed for dry cleaning. You, sir, we're sitting on the bench. Do you have a moment to speak to an alien? You have a doggy bag from Coco's? Yes? I see you waiting for your wife? Yes. A VFW hat?
Yes, I'm a veteran of foreign wars myself. Yes.
Would you like to hear the story of my people? Yes, we were from Bajor, much like the Jews. We were decimated by a superior race, the Cardassians, reptilian folk. The last memory I have of my parents is I was making paper dolls in the attic. Yes, we have attics. We are not barbarians. And I heard the cries of my parents and I ran down the stairs. Yes, yes, we have stairs! You think us imbeciles? I'm sorry, I'm defensive. And there I found the bodies of my parents flayed from stem to stern by the deadly Cardassian toenail. And all I have left to remember them by is this bloody paper doll. Yes, it does look like a napkin from Steak in the Cup with ketchup on it. It looks like that, but it is not. It is not, my friend. Are you one of the deniers of the Holocaust? Would you like to play an improv game with the Vulcan?
That's because thank you so much. Does anybody here not have health insurance? Okay, what's the plan? What are you gonna do? You die? Okay, that's a good plan. Maybe write it down. You should forget, die, see? I mean, but not for something small. Like if you got a rash, you'd be okay. Just put some cream on it. Like you've got cream, right? Just get some cream. I got a couple things. Got an air conditioning unit and a scuba diving mask. And I figure I could set that up, you know, any situation, you know, let it cool the cancer, you know. Because cancer's hot, right? And then if I get pregnant, I got a level. Looks good. Looks good from here. And then there's a lot of mental illness in my family, so if you catch schizophrenia, we get $4 of Mike and Ike's, a Bible, and a cage. Wait it out. I didn't have health insurance for a while, and so I went to a free clinic. And sometimes the word free can also mean crappy, shitty, no good. And went to the crappy, shitty, no good free clinic, got some crappy, shitty, no good free medicine, and had a crappy, shitty, no good $5,000 allergic reaction. And had I known the ambulance ride was going to be $2,000, I would have said, let's see the city. Make a few stops. And I didn't have the money, and I had my ID and everything, so they billed me, and I couldn't pay it, so they started just sending collection agencies, and those guys are wily. You know, hi, Marie, it's Christine. Hi, Christine. How are you? Great. How are you? Who are you? Christine from Western Financial Solutions.
Hi, Christine.
Do you have a job yet?
No.
And they just start getting trickier. Hey, is Ray there? Yeah, this is Ray. Hey, it's Alex. Oh my God. you know who this is, do you? Yeah,
of course. Yeah, of course I do.
Yeah, I mean, it's been a while, but from Western Financial Solutions. God damn you people! So cruel. They stopped calling me because if you send them a letter saying they can't call you, they can't legally call you unless they're IRS or their colleges, just an FYI. And but then they started sending me letters, threatening letters. We are now taking action. Oh, okay. We are now taking action. What's happening? You need to set up a payment plan. I have a payment plan. I'm sending you $2 a month over a period of 7 million years. I did eventually pay them off, and that was good. But now I have health insurance, and I have a new one. It's good. It's reasonable. And I have some, because I need to go see a specialist, because you ever have, like, a dark thought, like a really dark thought, like, what if I licked a urinal? Oh my God, why didn't I even think of that? What if I'm a urinal licker? What if I'm out of control? And every time I gotta go past a men's restroom, I've gotta do a complicated series of steps like a Scrabble board in order to get past it and clench my teeth together, because I'd fall over and I'd be out of control and I'd lick it. Okay, if that made sense to you, you might have OCD. When I was a kid, as about 10 years old, I stopped being able to sleep at night because I was worried. I was really anxious that I was a raper or a murderer or a genocider. And like, I'd never been a violent kid. The worst thing I'd ever done, I'd given a roundhouse to the breadbasket of Pat Stauffenecker, who frankly had it coming. And but I was super scared, and I thought I was trying to control myself, so in case, you know, so I wouldn't genocide anybody. And I would clench my fists at odd intervals and then try not to make any eye contact, and then later, no human contact at all.
Cut to 26 years later. Time flies when you are anxious. And
I decided to, you know, Google some of the symptoms, and came up with the OCD specialist, and I went there, and she just had me face my fears.
So what would happen if you made eye contact with somebody?
I'd genocide them.
And then what would happen?
I'd go to genocide jail.
And then what would happen?
I'd genocide everybody in the jail.
And then what would happen?
They'd have to put me in a freaking super strong jail.
And then what would happen?
This is stupid. You're not doing it right.
The best part was that I got to hear what other people's anxieties were. Because, you know, she asked me...
So have you ever avoided going to a religious institution because you were worried you'd lose control, run up on the altar, take a shit, and yell, I'm a promise keeper?
No, I mean, that seems reasonable.
Have you ever not gone to SeaWorld because you were worried if you were left alone with a tide pool, you would take a baby starfish and try to kiss its poop hole?
No, but I am not going to SeaWorld. I'm not going to SeaWorld.
Okay. Have you ever just avoided maybe working with someone vulnerable like the mentally retarded because you're worried you'd chop them up into chunks, have sex with the chunks, put the chunks on a Caesar salad and feed that salad back to your parents?
Yes, like a million times I told you. A million billion times. Stupid.
Oh, I'm sorry. It's been a long day. I keep confusing you with the guy who won't eat baby carrots because they're like the genitalia of Jesus on the cross. It's very...
What? No more baby carrots for me.
Anyways,
but I have a new health insurance, fantastic. It's called Value Options. Call in. It's just one woman who answers the phone. She's extremely supportive. Her name is Shirley.
Okay. Okay, so you have, like, psychological problems.
Yes. I need a referral for a therapist.
Okay. So it's not something you can talk about with your friends.
Why talk about it? But they're like, why can't you come out tonight? And I say, because I'm filthy. They say, take a shower. I say, no, it's on the inside.
Okay. So you crazy.
Well, I thought the clinical diagnosis would be obsessive compulsive disorder.
You know what I do when I feel down? I'm too blessed to be stressed. When I feel down, I go out and see a comedy show. You ever get your laugh on?
Yes, I have, Shirley. Yes, I have.
Or maybe you ain't seen a funny one.
Oh, touche, madame. Parry and thrust!
You ever go down to Laugh Factory? They have a Latino Fridays. That's pretty funny. And they got Mo Better Mondays. That's for black people. We only get one day of the week to laugh. White people laugh every day of the week. Ha, ha, ha.
You know what the saddest place in the world is? Arguably, the saddest place in the world is when you're the temp and it's time for office birthdays and you didn't get the email because you're not on the system yet, man. And you hear the voice of your coworkers rise, happy birthday, everybody in the office had their birthday this month. And if you cup your Weight Watchers mug against the conference room door, you can almost hear the happy scraping of plastic fork against paper plate. And later, someone will come by your cube.
It's like, oh, there's cake left. Did anybody want any cake? Oh, did the temp get any cake? What's her name again? Hey, Marnia. If you want, there's cake left. If you want, there's cake.
Cake.
tempon cake. Tempin good. Tempin copying and filing. Tempon cake.
Oh, you know what? Regie's gonna take the rest of it home. Sorry, there's no cake left. Sorry.
And that's when you find if you put 6 packets of Swiss Miss and a few jiggers of non-dairy creamer in a mug in the microwave for 8 minutes, it tastes nothing like a delicious piece of chocolate cake. It's a sad story. It's a sad one. I've been seeing this therapist. I can't say it properly because I don't take it seriously. And she said, why don't, you know, everybody has so much anxiety now, like all the anxiety, you know, she said, why don't
you sing your anxieties aloud? You know, take the power away from them. I mean, make a little song. Take the power. Let's call those anxieties, let's call them gremlins. Let's call those anxieties gremlins.
Well, why don't we just call them anxieties?
Would you feel more comfortable with goblins?
Yes. So this is a new song I'm working on. If I keep my ice cube trays filled, it'll be okay. As long as I clench my fists at odd intervals, then the darkness that's within me won't force me to do things I don't want to do that are inappropriately violent. As long as I keep singing this song, I won't turn gay. And God can't kill me. It can't get you if you're singing a song. Yeah. It's helping. It's helping enormously. Are there any formerly troubled teens here tonight? Guys, you still are? Hey, how'd you get in here? Oh, were you guys smoking, toking, joking, not taking authority too seriously? Am I right? That's what you're doing, just like me. I hear that. I was a bit of a dark kid. I was reading in the United States, lots of kids are suffering from depression. Younger and younger, our children are seeing the sippy cup as half empty. And I was a bit of a dark kid. I'd occasionally stage my own death for fun. Mother, I've taken a whole bottle of pills.
Oh my God, what did you take?
Tums.
Maria, those are your father's.
What, mother? I can't hear you. The calcium is coursing through my veins. So I'm a dark kid. I never really thought of myself as depressed, though, as much as paralyzed by hope. I did go through a dark period of time. And I went on medication. My miniature hamster, Benita, passed on. She didn't pass on. I returned to the pet store, but she's dead to me. Nobody bites Mama. And went through a dark period. And a friend of mine told me, you know, there's no shame in going on medication for depression because depression is a medical condition. You know, you wouldn't say to a friend with a broken leg, you wouldn't say, what? You gonna go see a doctor? You never heard of making a splint? Sure, you got bone jutting out of your skin. Life doesn't always turn out as you planned. At least you got bones. You're not some gelatinous encephalopod without friends or prospects. Walk it off! You might not say that, but if you did, it would be funny. Okay. This is a homeopathic remedy for depression. If you don't have insurance, not sure what to do. Here's what you do. Take a blue or a black pen. You draw a rabbit's face atop your own face, okay? Make some rabbit ears out of paper plates, cotton balls. I don't know what you have. You make some fudge, which is very easy to make from what I have read. And you go out on your front porch. You open up your window, and you start yelling at people. jackass!
One thumb foot.
Hey, pretty lady! Oh, it's a guy, sorry.
One thumb foot.
Hi. Oh, how are you? Yeah, it's not doing so good. It gets you out and about in your community. And it shows everyone that you need help. So infinitely healing. I get mad and stuff. Because, like, there's still stigma, about talking about any kind of mental illness. Like, they don't talk about mental illness the way they do other illnesses, you know? So I was like, wow. Yeah, apparently, Steve has cancer. It's like, fuck off. We all have cancer, right? Right? I have cancer pretty bad right now, but I get it taken care of. I go to chemotherapy, I get back to work.
Yeah, I was dating this chick, and apparently, she needs contact lenses, you know, all this time. She wears glasses, and I was just like, I don't believe in all that Western medicine shit, you know? If you want to see, like, other people, it's all about attitude. You gotta want it. You gotta want it.
You just think you would be able to stop vomiting for me and the kids.
All right. I get super mad about this problem. I feel like people don't go for help because, you know, it was still, you know, because people would rather not go into the hospital and they'd rather jump off a bridge because that's less dramatic. And over 7,000 U.S. veterans die of suicide every year, which is funny because you think they die over there, but they come home, right? I thought it must be funny because nobody was taking it that seriously. And get so mad about it. These guys are asking for help, and no one will. I have been in that position, and I have had my friends and family wrap a little blanket burrito around my meats and cheeses. They put a little feed bag of microwave popcorn around my neck, because it's going to be a 12-hour wait at the ER. And I was taken to Lost at Sea Hospital, because sometimes you're lost at sea. And there, you'll walk for at least 72 hours around a cement courtyard with a schizophrenic man with no teeth and no pants who keeps saying things like,
"It gets better."
I do not believe you, but you're very sweet.
Yeah, so most people never think of suicide. They only think of it in terms of, oh, the stewardess won't give me the whole can. Oh, turbulence. I want to live. I've been seeing this life coach. Have you heard of a life coach? You heard of a life coach? I thought a life coach is going to be like, come on, get out there. You can take that guy. You got the sack. But it's not. It's just about setting goals. And these are my three goals. Number one, master and defeat death. Number two, kidnap George Bush, put him in a little camp where he's safe and warm but unable to rule. Safe and warm. Safe and warm, unable to rule. Number three, drink more water. Am I right, ladies? Oh, God. So I've been trying to achieve my goals. Does anybody here have any goals tonight? Do you have any goals that you're working on? No? You do? You're getting drunk? Oh, that's good. How's it going? Good. It sounds like it's going really good. Well, I mean, you're achieving right now. I was a little anxious about my goals, and all you have to do, you know, do one little thing toward your goal. So, okay, master defeat death. Well, I can't do that all in one day. But what I can do today is I can stretch. Oh! Because that's if I'm going to be wrestling the dark force of evil. And paddling down the river Styx. I don't want to pull anything. Anyways, also, my life coach said, well, you know, what's the feeling you want to get from kidnapping George Bush, put in a little camp where he's safe and warm and unable to rule? And, well, I think I'm going to feel joyful, at peace, and sense that everything's going to be okay. Guess what? If you pour raisin bran into a bowl and then put 2% milk all the way up to the top, but not going over, but all the way up to the top, not going over, same feeling. Drinking more water, I can't do it. I can't do it. So now I'm just going to keep my mouth open when I'm in the shower. That way, anything gets in there, it's just gravy. Oh, guys.
Trying to be a good person. Anybody here using canvas bags instead of the plastics? You doing that? You're not doing that? I'm not even using bags anymore, man. Because I've learned to juggle. Yeah. I can only shop in groups of three, but that's not stopping me. I'm also, this is my last outfit. I'm no longer consuming. This is it. Now I'm just going to borrow stuff.
You going to use that money?
I've started, every morning I carry my clay jug on my head down to the 7-Eleven, fill that with Diet Coke, bring it back to the community well. I think that seems to be really disturbing people. I started taking the bus, and
where are you right now?
I'm on the bus. Oh my God.
What happened to your car?
It's fine, I decided to take the bus.
Do you need me to pick you up?
No. No, I'm on the bus.
Maria, are you okay?
I don't know anymore.
I am trying to be a good person like all of us, right? My sister has become a life coach, and so I'm kind of trying to challenge her with my negative thoughts.
Hey, Marie, you got one for me?
Sure. A word on too old to be in show business.
Betty White, Dame Judi Dench, Joan Rivers, you're not old enough. Hit me.
Okay, fear I'll never be in a loving, committed relationship.
Oof, I don't know. Pass. I'll go back.
Okay, fear of this scenario. You lose everything, including your mind, except the part of your mind that knows that you lost everything. Somehow you end up in the Philippines, walking the streets of Manila, in a bunch of itchy, filthy sweater remnants, plucking a one-string banjo. Plink! Plink!
Plink! No baggage. Hitting bottom is a jumping off point.
What a gift. Is anyone thinking of suicide? Oh. Don't do it. Not the season for it. Late fall.
That's gonna help. Well, I think I'm gonna stick around and see how angry people can get at me.
Mad at you. So, that's good. I've been really concerned also about celebrity chef Paula Deen. Because her recipes really now read like a suicide note.
Yo, we gonna be making some sweet dreams.
Little balls of butter, shortening Crisco, fatback, cracklings, blubber suet, margarine, mayonnaise. Each day I wake to a fresh nightmare. The pain is too great. Gonna roll that in some granulated sugar. Powdered sugar, candy, candy cone, gummy sneaks, Mentos, cookies, zoom, zoom. Some nerds, don't look for me. I've made a plan and I will follow through with it. Gonna drizzle out some hot fudge. Heavy cream, whipping cream, sour cream, ice cream, cake, batter, peanut butter, french fry, stuffed marshmallow, fluff waffle. An egg. Bon appetit and goodbye.
So nice. My favorite show are those shows where they go to celebrity houses, like they have E-Celebrity Homes or MTV Cribs. E-Celebrity Homes, they always have some TV superstar like Meredith Baxter Burney walking around her castle saying stuff like,
this is the kitchen. This is where my heart is. My husband and I, we decided to move to Malibu because we love the fresh air, and to walk out on our own private beach was really important to us. You know what? Looks like the tide's coming in, so let's go take a look at the view.
I want to have my own show where we just go to the apartments of my friends and call it Comedian Homes.
This is the kitchen. This is where the bathroom, the bedroom, the 300 square feet where my apartment is located. We decided to move to downtown Los Angeles because they don't check your credit references. And that was really important to us. You know, and I hear the sirens, so let's go sit on the futon, look through the bars on the window, and watch the helicopter circle.
Yeah, I love TV. Like, have you seen those home decorating shows? Gosh, they're getting really mean now. Like, they'll just do anything. They don't care. You know, just screw up your entire house and just go, sorry.
You signed a waiver.
You know, just be like,
do you like the new wall covering in the bathroom? Does it feel familiar? It's your baby's skin.
A little too dark? Okay. Yeah. I don't know. Okay, that's a keeper. Okay.
Fantastic. Oh, that's nice.
It's a keeper. Oh, you ever seen Nigella Lawson? She has a food show. She's like English. She's like,
put 18 pounds of butter in a pot and then sit in it.
Chosen about food. Oh man, like TV. You know, when you get famous enough, then that means you can do makeup commercials and stuff like that. Have you seen those ones that sort of, like, they'll have, like, the, you know, whatever, those famous actresses, you know, Susan Sarandon, and be like, don't deny your age, defy it! She's pissed off. She's angry, and she's gonna do something about it. And, I don't know, I wanna do a makeup commercial, I'd do one. My old lip color could barely keep up with my busy schedule. And the time it takes to notice the wide discrepancy between my salary and that of my male peers, I'd have to reapply. Yeah, seconds to count the number of women in high political offices, seated on corporate executive boards, and featured in film and television over the age of 40, my lip color would be as invisible as this glass ceiling only inches above my head. L'Oreal, because I am worth it. And because holding myself to an impossible standard of beauty keeps me from starting a riot.
Yeah.
ladies. Harold! That's so nice. The guys cheering. That's nice. Somebody's gonna get some. No, that's nice.
I'm originally from Little Lake Pequom, Minnesota. Little Lake Pequom and the Hizzat and the Sheezy. I'm a single lady. I know that's surprising that a piece of this goodness is freaking sweetness. Still be out on the market. Super Fox. I mean, where I come from, LA has been a little bit tough, because where I come from, Little Lake Pequom, I am a goddess. I just slap on some blue eyeshadow and head out. But, it's pretty tough. My manager's got me a subscription to a women's magazine, so I get some tips on how to increase the foxification of this area right here. This area. And, you know, I figure out, you know, I only need one of those magazines because he gets the same dang article every month. He always have 3 ways to shape up for summer. Number 1, eat less. Number 2, exercise more. What was I talking about? I am so fucking hungry right now. Well, Zeva, 3 ways to drive your man wild. Okay, number 1, tell him you're dying. Seriously, it creates a sense of urgency. He's like, you want to go out Friday night? You're like, no, I got chemo. How about tonight? Okay, number 2, you dress up as like a hooker, but like a really self-determined hooker with really nice clothes. Number 3, have sex with him. Seriously, they love it. I have my own magazine where I'm in every picture, looking super fine. Every article's asking me how I can possibly maintain my perfect 32AA. Can I get a witness from any of my girlfriends from Japan? 32AA. They're precious, rare miniatures. I was thinking about getting breast implants because I am a radical, militant feminist and a hypocrite. Turns out, and I was trying to rationalize it, you know, saying that getting implants, you know, it's just like the jungle tribeswoman who says to the National Geographic translator,
I know there are going to be physical implications if I insert a 9.5-inch diameter clay lip plate into my mouth, but I'm doing this for me, and it also represents how many cattle my husband receives at the time of our engagement.
Yeah. I was trying to rationalize it. Like, my neighbor has implants, but she's in porn, so she has them for work. They're deductible. I always looked down on porn. You know, I thought, you know, looked down on it. But now I realize I was just jealous. Nobody's ever asked me to have sex for money. Sure, a Bud Light and a basket of curly fries. But not cash. Those shows, you know, on Showtime, you know, or cable, saying how great the sex industry is, you know, and they, you know, talk to somebody who's all pumped about it, and, you know, talk to some woman named Juicebox, you know, and she's all,
I wasn't abused as a child. I don't do drugs or alcohol. I just love sex. I'm just a very sexual person. When working in an unregulated industry that provides no legal recourse, should I be repeatedly victimized? Kind of makes me feel hot.
You go, girl. Tough. I don't know if it is okay there, but they got all these standards for you. You used to be in Hollywood, you just had to be skinny, and somehow I got that down. Thanks to my genetic. Thanks, Poppy. Thanks, Mom. But now, not only you have to be skinny, but you had to have muscle tone, so it's like, I'm all tired and hungry, but I gotta go work out. Heads up for next year, this is gonna be the new style. You're gonna have to, you wanna be on the cutting edge, you're gonna have to have a giant egg-shaped torso, okay? With tiny little Tweety Bird ankles and a wandering eye.
Stick with it. 42, and I have, I'm dating, I'm on eHarming Me as well as Attached.com, and,
okay, stupid.
And, things are going great. But I have, I've had lots of wonderful relationships, and then I heard this comic say,
yeah, if a woman's over 40 and she's never been married, there's something wrong with her.
Oh, no!
Sometimes I worry about dying alone, but, I'm fun. And,
and sooner or later, they're gonna wheel your wheelchair into a wall and forget about you for 5 hours. Miss Bamford, we'd wonder where you'd gone.
Oh, I was just working on this puzzle in the air. I finished the old mill, now I'm finding pieces of sky.
You gonna see Mr. Peterson later on today?
Oh, we're just keeping it casual.
You're doing a great job.
Oh, who's that?
Your self-esteem.
I used to be very afraid of relationships. I'm not sure why. somebody would ask me out. I'd say, just take my purse. Don't hurt me.
No, I just want to get to know you.
I have nothing of value.
Anyway, you just seem like an interesting person.
Who sent you? I'm getting better at it, though. I'm getting better. It's just not my greatest gift. You know, sometimes people are very confident, and I hope to be like that someday. I hope to be like,
yeah, we just both met. We both just kind of knew.
Oh, man. So you guys ever fight about anything?
Oh, he doesn't like onions.
So you never had any issues you had to work through with, like, a fucking workbook?
You know, if I were you, I'd just watch out for red flags.
Oh, okay. But what if I'm like a flag factory that only manufactures giant red flags?
Maybe you need to learn to be the one before you meet the one.
Is that from Bob Dylan? Is that... He's so funny. Well done. Hey, good luck. Yeah, good luck. Good luck with whatever you're doing.
Good luck with whatever you're doing, Merlin. Merlin, the magician with your book of spells and potions. Oh my gosh. Okay, I got a little confused. You got a loud laugh, girl.
I high five it. I appreciate it. It's a little distracting, slightly distracting. Gotta say. I love you. I love you. I love you. Oh Lord. Because if you've ever been in a bad relationship, like if you ever had one, I had one where, you know, if your partner says something like, "Hey babe, I just want to let you know, I would never hit you." Oh, you're gonna be getting a beat down.
Yep.
Right, quick, brace for impact. Papa's coming home.
Want to get out of that as soon as possible. I know the signs of domestic violence because I have been an off and on, pretty volatile relationship with myself. And I'll say it quiet because I know I get upset. I know it seemed charming when we're together. But whenever it's just me, you know, all of a sudden, for no reason at all, and I can't really predict. I mean, I could be so sweet. I could be so sweet. Yeah, I'll go to the pet store and I'll buy myself a hermit crab and paint the shell in my favorite NFL team colors, you know? So sweet. But then sometimes I'll start yelling at myself. Why don't you go to the gym and have a baby? I am dating on the internet, and the great thing, it's going so well since I stopped lying. Sometimes I lie because I, you know, like somebody says, "Oh, have you seen that movie?" I was like, "Yeah, scary. I haven't seen it. I just want to be with you." Wish I could be a vegetarian, because I've seen all the horrible videos of those animals, you know, pigs lined up in front of their children and shot that close. I haven't seen that, but I imagine that's what I could never watch those videos. It looks so scary. But I would like to think that I'd be an Oscar Schindler in the face of a systematic genocide. But first they came for the ice cream cones, and I said nothing. Because I was not an ice cream cone. All right. I wish they provide recipes for food they can get at the gas station. Have you ever had a gas station tuna fish sandwich? Oh my God, it's so good. Because there's no tuna in it. It's just a scrumptious, fishy nougat. Or a gas station muffin. Oh, you'd have to start with the color yellow. Oh, those beautiful blonde giants, how do they seem so real? I always want to call up one of those public radio cooking shows and say,
"Hi, my husband and I, we love this show, and we're having guests come over at 6, so I'm going to pick up the Dr. Pepper Slurpees at 5:45. The corn dog taquitos, in order to keep them warm, do I just sit on them?" I'll take my answer off the air.
Maybe we should get to know each other a little bit more deeply. Does anyone here have a poor credit history? It's okay. It's a safe space. I don't know when I'm gonna pay them back, but it's gonna be soon.
Super soon, I'm totally gonna pay it back. Super soon.
I really think before giving me a credit card, they really should have given me a math test. Like a series of story problems. Question number one, if Maria works as a comedian for $100 a week but spends $20 a day on hair scrunchies, how many years will it take for her to pay off a Taco Bell gordita she bought in 1992? That's a good question. Question number two, if Maria's boyfriend is in a folk band, but he only smokes pot every other day, what percentage of the rent will he be able to contribute? Yeah. I thought 50%, but the answer is zero. Yeah. That's good to know. That's gonna be on the test, it really is. Question number three. If Maria moved to Hollywood at the age of 22 in order to become a TV superstar, the age of 35 has only succeeded in getting her cable television turned off, what fraction of her dream will have died? Well, that's a trick question, because you have to factor in my unsinkable sense of confidence, which compounds interest daily. People in Los Angeles are always trying to get you to buy stuff. You should get an iPad. I already have a Walgreens notebook. Why do I?
You should get one, because they're flat. Have you seen the new Ford Flex?
What is it?
It's a car building. It's a house truck.
Listen, I already got a Toyota Echo, Echo, Echo.
Tennis bracelets are in sale. They're covered in diamonds and they're only $300.
What? I don't even play wear jewelry.
You should. You should.
I don't even know how to play tennis.
You should buy tennis lessons.
People love you to buy stuff. This is an exciting part of the show. This poor guy keeps getting calls at my house. And it's been 5 years now. They do not believe that I am not Ernesto Martinez. And I think it is time for me to speak on his behalf. Spanish isn't very strong, but...
Sí. Yo soy Ernesto. Oh, it's Chase Bank? Oh, Banco de Chase. Oh, sí. Oh, lo siento. Oh, I'm so sorry! I'm so sorry!
Chase Bank, I'm self-employed. How long do you want to stay on the phone? All right. Do you ever find yourself being a total jackass for no apparent reason? Yeah. I find I like to bring it in retail situations. I just get all hopped up on Diet Coke and Jolly Ranchers. Go to Target. You're like, you know what? If you can't help me, then I need to speak with someone who can. Because this is a $3 pair of flip-flops. Oh, I'll wait. Yeah, I'm returning a pair of rubber shoes on a Friday night. I got time! I wish I'd get mad about something that actually, you know, kind of mattered. Mm. go in Target, be like, you know what? If you can't help me, then I need to speak with someone who can, because this is a $3 pair of flip-flops made by a 5-year-old Guatemalan girl, and I'm not leaving until she gets benefits and an education under the NAFTA Fair Trade Agreement. Yeah. You better go get a manager. This could take a while. Oh, sometimes it's fun to be evil. I'm generally pro-good, anti-evil. But sometimes it's fun to be evil just in little ways. Just with your friends and family. Be like my mom, you know, oh, mother, I told you I'd call you right back, but I didn't. You've just been lied to by your demon seed. Just around the neighborhood. Oh, Subway sandwich shop. I bet you allocated one straw per customer. But guess who took 5? You just had your inventory reeked upon by the dark one. Oh, little old man on SoCo. I asked you for directions, and halfway through you giving them, I decided to go back to the motel and take a nap, but I acted like I was still listening. You just had your time wasted by the beast. Okay, that's a new joke, and some of my jokes are my babies, and I push them out far before they know how to walk. Okay, let's take that back. Oh, man, so, I was trying to, I thought maybe I could help people, like I was a troubled teen. I thought, you know, maybe I could help some troubled teens, right? And I went, tried to be a mentor. And they had an interview with a social worker. And I may or may not, at the interview, been wearing 2 mismatched prints. I may or may not have slam-a-jammed 64-ounce Mountain Dewski right before the interview. And I may or may not have answered some of their questions in a number of different voices. Yeah, I went to the college. Out east. Oh. Not so good. And so I guess they said, you know what, we need to have a third interview with you because the notes from the social worker is that you seem anxious, high-strung, and eccentric. Yeah, that's what I do. That's the cornerstone. It's the business plan. And then they found out in the meantime, they said, oh, we found out I was a comedian. They said, oh, it's fine. We get it. You know, would you perform for our benefit? Oh, I see. Dirty monkey not okay. But dirty monkey dance? Oh, dirty monkey won't dance for you. But I find it very hard to connect with people because I just am a little shy and trying to say hi to people in my neighborhood. And I'm not extroverted. But I was reading that people who are developmentally disabled often bring entire communities together because they lack the social awareness that makes loneliness possible. They're so stupid. So this dum-dum is raising my emotional intelligence, taking a page from that book of mostly pictures, and you know, just be more myself, you know, just unfiltered at my local cafe. Hi, Sandy! Hi, Sonny! Hi, Gerardo! Hi! What's your name? You got your earbuds in, hipster. What's your name? My name's Dave. Hi, Dave! What are you doing on your laptop? I'm just working on something for my band. Dave's in a band, everybody! Dave plays music! Dave. I'm writing a book about hogs. It's called Hog Book. pour myself a grande, a free half and half, because it's free! Hey, Maria, do you want some crumbs from the bakery case in a bowl? Yes, I would, Gerardo, thank you! Gerardo plays music too, Dave. Let's talk about music. I don't like it. Anyways, getting to know people. I'm trying to connect with people in my neighborhood. More, I've been starting to mentor kids without telling anyone. And it's going great.
You're weird.
You're weird.
My mom's gonna kill you.
My mom's gonna kill you.
I'm gonna tell my mom I've been swearing in front of us.
Oh, God damn you. I already fucking told my mom some of the shit you said to me.
You're the only white person on our block.
I know!
Why do you move here? Because I'm Mexican. It's a Mexican.
That's racist.
No, I can say I'm Mexican because I'm Mexican.
Oh, rah, 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 rah. La maestra becomes el estudiante.
My dad said you're a comedian.
Yes.
Tell me a joke.
It's not like that.
How can you be a comedian if you don't have any jokes?
Okay. Call my manager. He'll explain everything. I am running for neighborhood council. I've got the ad campaign. It's just going to be a shot of me laying face down in my dusty backyard surrounded by my elderly, overweight dogs.
Maria Bamford for Eagle Rock Neighborhood Council. She can do it if it's on a Tuesday.
It's just like once a month, right? Certain English phrases you really don't learn until you've been here at least a couple hundred years. Things like,
why vote? Who cares? It doesn't even fucking matter.
And I'm like,
yeah, I'm not racist, but they're lazy.
Oh. It just sounds racist when you say it. My favorite English phrase that I have been using a lot frequently is, yeah, I need money, but I'm not going to work as a fucking fill in the blank. Very difficult to enunciate that. That I got to keep the silver spoon between my cheek and gum.
My sister's very smart, and I've been trying to get smarter. This is a CD, so people probably won't be able to see this, but if they can use their hands at home, maybe they can. I'm learning more about geography through my hands. Here's Africa, right? A palm split. Then the lower part, that's where Oprah's teaching everybody how to give makeovers. And then here's the middle part, right? That's Chad, the Sudan, a lot of rough stuff, because they don't know the secret. And then here's a...
Here's England. England. We act like we're smarter than the United States, but in fact we're just mumbling.
What?
You wouldn't understand. American educational system. The fish and chips conservatory of 1312.
And then here's Eastern Europe. Everybody's doing contortion gymnastics because there's no human rights law, so all the kids have to get in a Cirque du Soleil. And then here's China. We're making stuff. We're making stuff. And here's
India. Oh, there is not enough room for the phone lines. Travelocity, this is Susan.
And here's the Middle East. Here's the church. Here's the mosque. Open the temple. Everybody's mad. And then here's Australia. Oh, we're bigger landmasses. You're on a state, epic steakhouse. We didn't even own that. So the fucking guy from Florida, why don't you all get fucked? And then
South America, which statistically is Southern Central America, the happiest people in the world, because we value family, relationship, leisure time.
Shut up, it's the US, Los Angeles, New York, Midwest. Motherfuckers, fuck you. We're landlocked. And then Canada's like, oh, we're so sorry about those guys, we're so sorry. And it's like, what? Canada's like, we're so sorry. So sorry. And it's just like boom, 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 oh no, oh no, be quiet, no, it's okay, baby. Ten cuidado, los Estados Unidos, ten cuidado. Tranquilo, tranquilo.
Okay. So, yeah. Basically gonna work out. I learned one more history now. It's important, you don't wanna repeat history. So far I got bugs, Jesus, top hats, diet sodas. Trying to fill in the blanks there. I like to learn more about politics, but I don't like competition, you know. I come from the Midwest where it's sort of like,
oh, that sounds like a good idea. Whatever you just said, that I wasn't really listening. Fascism? Sure. Brown shirt, and we all do the same thing. Sounds great. Oh, we don't like the Jews either.
So I try to speak from my opinion. I tried to take a debate class, and my favorite part of the class, and you said,
excellent point, my friend. Let us retire to the drawing room. Where we may draw.
But I do have political cadence. I'm trying to get that down in case I do want to share my opinions at some point. I know how to share them.
Confident from the chest, joke, referencing a recent criticism of my campaign. Story of a black, white, Asian pine ghost who is fake and who I am pretending and in a very made-up way. Plan. Vague, complicated plan to eradicate sadness. And now wrapping up to repeat the same thing. Dance to win hope. Dance to win justice. As if to myself in a prayer, dance to win courage. Now rushing off as if to build affordable housing, but in fact, just gonna go order a $35 Caesar salad at the Hilton. Practice gratitude, local reference.
I don't like competition. I don't like my favorite game when I was a kid was popcorn. That's when you take a parachute and you spread it out between like 10 people, and then you put wiffle balls in it. It's popcorn. It's the game where everybody wins.
It's a low skill level.
And love popcorn. Portland, I used to be like you. I used to know the difference between right and wrong. You know? I could move here, I could grow up my hair into a cape. And get on my bike that I've made out of harpsichords and use the wind to power my artisanal crumpet factory. Have horrible arguments on the street with people who have the exact same opinion that I do on every issue.
I think healthcare and education should be a priority.
Me too!
Let's go craft.
if I lived here, I'd do everything I ever dreamed of. I'd get like a ram's horn put on starboard, and then I'd have like a couple of, you know, buck teeth, maybe a side snaggle. You know? I'd say things on public transportation like, I'm gonna just cancel my subscription to Conscious Dance. But I used to be a good person. I used to go to sleep to the click-clackety-clack of a loom making an ill-fitting wool hat later to be sold for fair trade prices. I protested every war. I put a peace sign on my face, the Gulf War. What I thought was a peace sign turns out to be the Mercedes-Benz logo. A foreshadowing. I've played a music instrument poorly while busking for change on the street.
Hey, do you play any Tchaikovsky?
You got a dollar?
Oh, that doesn't sound like Czech. I'm not the one who's trying to buy their classical music on the street!
But then what happened is I moved to Los Angeles and I lost 10 pounds because they take away the food before you're done.
You're done.
And I got the stomach flu for a month and everyone kept telling me, you look amazing. I know. Makes you think how good we'll look when we're dead. I was at my grandma's funeral, open casket. I was like, you got this, girl. You got this. My manager suggested it might be time for me to get some Botox, and this is only through sound, so you'll just have to imagine what I'm doing, but I said, oh, I don't know. I don't know if it's time for me to get it, because I'm still using my face. Yeah? I mean...
Is this no longer relevant?
But you know what happens, you know, I started working for the man, you know, I needed health benefits, so I just started typing, you know, being a secretary, typing out what he had to say. It's like you're taking back the night from inside the machine, because it makes a difference to your starfish, right? Right? And then I wanted to be on TV, you know, spread my message, and the man owns that, and, turns out I had to make a couple changes to my jokes just to so as not to upset his buddies / corporate entities. And made those changes, and then the man said, I'll give you a big bag of money if you just say exactly what I want you to say.
And I took that big bag of money. And I said exactly what he wanted me to say.
And now I'm redecorating my house in shades of gray.
All right, you guys, I am trying to get more spiritual, I mean more self-righteous, and I hope nobody here is deeply religious. If you are, please just rest in the glory that I am wrong. I doubt that's true. I wish science would come up with a brain ride where you can get inside somebody's brain and see like all their thoughts and their experiences and their memories and why they believe and think the way they do and how they see the world. And I know there's a low-tech version just called listening, but I want a this radio station in Cleveland, oh. And, you know, Creative Portland, when you've made something wonderful and then it just sprang from you. You know, like maybe it's your laugh. Like, maybe you made, like it's what you, it's coming out. You can't, like you made a hat of your mother's hair, right? Or you made a painting of the seaside all in black because that's how you fucking see it, man. On this radio show, and fair enough, the guy did not like my stylings. I had showed him my wares that I've made out of reclaimed woods and sheepskins, and he was not into it. And what he said was, whoa, I don't get it. Apparently this woman's supposed to be funny. I just think she is schizophrenic. Well, that is clearly not my mental illness. I am bipolar 2, which is the new gladiator sandal. And schizophrenia is, of course, hearing voices, not doing voices. I am trying to develop an animated series to educate people. I'm Sid, the schizophrenic squid. Say hello. I might say hi back if I'm not distracted by the cacophony of sensory hallucinations that bombard me at every turn. Oh, shut up, Santa. My feet are on fire. It's a hilarious disease. I always want to go back to that guy. Because, like, you know, it's about the easiest thing in the world to criticize something, right? It's like, click, don't like, boo, thumbs down. You know, you barely have to, you don't have to know how to operate a stained glass soldering iron to do that, you know? You don't need to know. You know, it takes courage, tenacity, you know? And if I had courage, which I don't think I could ever have the courage, but if I did have the courage, I would have said to the guy, hey, coward, you know, if you sing out your Batman poetry to a largely hostile Barnes & Noble crowd, or if you crank out a raw, unedited skull out of a Granny Smith apple, pop that on a Bratz doll torso, upload that to Etsy, price it high. If you think of doing a nude clown opera, you write it, you cast it, and you actually fucking do it? That doesn't show you're insane, much as it shows the symptoms of being hardworking and a huge success. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have to get back to the extended stay because I have faces to make in the bathroom mirror. You guys have been so delightful. I'm so grateful that you've all come out on a Wesenez. And, you know what I'm saying? I'm just freestyling now. Basically. This is a little game you can play with your friends and family. I hope you do if you don't already play it. Just leave you with it. It's a, my family we call it Joy Whack-A-Mole. What happens is that somebody brings up something that they're really happy about, and then the other person tries to slam it down. I was playing with my dad, and I was like, Dad, check out this new top. Oh, it's very nice. Yeah, guess how much? I don't know, $50. No, $5. Jesus, that's a good deal. Yeah, you got that right. It's like $5. How do they do it? Oh, I was reading about that. Slavery. Yeah, you put the manufacturing out of these countries. There's no labor laws, human rights violations, no environmental protection. And then they pass that savings on to you. Pretty sweet coat, though, Dad. It kind of skims the profile. My sister and I, of course, play Sarah, I think I met somebody. I mean, I don't know, but I think I'm excited about. I met this guy, and I'm excited.
Oh, good for you.
Good for you. Good for you.
That's awesome. It's awesome.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, you never know, but I guess you just enjoy the moment. Just enjoy the process. Enjoy the process.
Are you sure you haven't projected a fantasy on a trisexual stranger you met on petfinder.uk? You like I'm gay and out of town.
That happened like twice. That's not even a pattern. My mom is truly the king of this game, though. She's very good. Mom, Amy hit her baby. Oh, that is great news, honey. I mean, it's not the greatest news for the 600,000 kids in foster care in this country, but she wants a fresh one, huh? Jeez. Everybody wants one that looks like them. It's so selfish. Mama. I'm doing a show tonight. Oh, sweetie, I have a joke for you. A friend of mine is just a hoot. She said you could use it. And coincidentally, she was in foster care. She had been airlifted out of the Sudan in the late 90s because she had been bearmed and belegged by the Janjaweed, the horseback militia. Anywho, she'd love to do stand-up. She's hilarious, but she can't. And it's really a hospice situation, just a matter of time. But the priest comes in and he asks her, would you like us to light a candle for you in the chapel? Well, she says, sassy as you please, teletyping through her eyelids, well, how many candles you got? Because so many horrible things have happened to her and keep happening. Sweetie, have a good show tonight. What you do is so important. Thank you guys so much.
I believe you guys have been great. I believe it's a song. I also sing, if you can believe it. All that talent all packed into this delicious package. Okay, join me if you know the words. It is an old American classic. Old MacDonald had a pterodactyl, E-I-E-I-O, with a... Donald had her dog go, yeah. Thanks so much. Thanks for coming to support live comedy. Thanks a lot.